at the American Society, Council of the Americas. I'm proud to serve as MC of our 11th annual Women's Hemispheric Network Conference, and I'm very excited to be with all of you here today. I would like to start off by thanking our WHN sponsors, WHN lead sponsors, Goldman Sachs and Organon & Co., corporate sponsors, Apple, Pfizer, and White & Case LLP. We have the support of CAF, Development Bank of Latin America, and our table leader supporter is Merck & Co. Thank you very much for your support. Before starting, I would like to remind everyone that this conference is on the record and we're live streaming directly on our website, so hello. You can also join the conversation on social media by using the hashtag #ASCOAWomen. Without further ado, I would like to kick us off by introducing our CEO and President, Susan Siegel, who will give welcoming remarks, followed by an interview with Sarah Aiosa, Senior Vice President and President of Latin America, Merck. Susan.
Well, first of all, thank you, Guillermo. And it is so exciting to be here. Wow, so many people joining us today for the first time in, I guess, 3 years since the pandemic. And I sit back and I look through the audience and I remember 10 years ago or 11 years ago when we started this and we had Michelle Bachelet on stage talking about this. And who would have guessed? That we could keep the initiative going and that it's more vibrant than ever. And the number of networks and people we've brought together has just exceeded all expectations. And frankly, we intend to keep going and keep going even stronger. So good morning, everyone, and welcome to our 11th annual Women's Hemispheric Network Conference in New York. Our first in-person, as I said, event in 3 years. And this past August, however, we were in San Paulo with a wonderful program. And earlier in the year, we were also in Miami with a wonderful program. And next year, as is tradition, we will take the Women's Hemispheric Network to Mexico. But we will also, I think, do a piece of our Latin American Cities program in Chile around women, because this is such an important topic in the country, and we believe that we can add value in Santiago on this topic, as the Chilean government is far more advanced in the public sector than they are in the private sector. Today, we are featuring women leaders and male allies for a discussion on women's empowerment and leadership in the Americas. This year, we are tackling important questions related to diversity and representation across sectors, work-life balance, and taking the risks to build the career that each of you want. Since 2012, the Women's Hemispheric Network has created spaces like this one to encourage and inspire young professionals to remain in the workforce, seek opportunities, become leaders, and be able to be whatever they want to be. After 10 years, we continue to serve as a platform for female leaders in the region to share their personal stories, give advice, and serve as role models. We are so pleased to have so many great speakers with us today to lead a dynamic and very important conversation. We're going to start off with our keynote interview with my dear friend, my new friend, Sarah Aiosa. She is the Senior Vice President of Latin America at Merck. She's the first Latina woman in this position. She sets the strategic direction and oversees pharmaceutical operations in human health across all of Latin American subsidiaries, encompassing 4,000 employees in more than 20 countries. That's really cool, right? Sarah holds a master's degree in public health from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health and a bachelor's degree in biological sciences from Rutgers University. She is married and has 3 kids, and I am really excited to be able to talk to her about her journey. Sarah, please join me on stage.
Sarah.
So this is a real honor to have you here today, and frankly, it's a real honor to have you on the board, so of the Americas Society, of the Council of the Americas. So you've had an amazing journey to get to where you are, and you've had to juggle a lot of things. Could you tell us a little bit about your journey?
Yes, thank you. Can you hear me okay? So first of all, I'd like to just acknowledge and recognize and thank the Council of the Americas, the Americas Society, for this kind invitation. Thanks as well to Susan, the organizers and the sponsors of this great event, all of you for coming today. And I want to recognize members of my team who've traveled from very near and far, who support me every day for the important work that we do at Merck on behalf of patients in America Latina. So just to quickly share a little bit about myself, and I've just included some pictures to share. I hope this is working. Let's see. Maybe I have this wrong. Okay, I'll just start talking. So I was born and raised in Newark, New Jersey, which itself is a city that has a rich and diverse history. This is a great quote. I got to meet Maya Angelou at one point in my life, so she really inspires me. And it's true. Each time a woman stands up and represents herself without knowing it, right, she's standing up for so many women. Still not working, but. So I was born and raised in Newark, New Jersey, and the daughter of a mother from Puerto Rico and a father from Ecuador. My first job was at a pharmacy, a local community pharmacy, and that's really what started my journey in health sciences. Pharmacies play such an important role in all of our communities, if you can think about that. I was a cashier, but I also learned how to count pills and put labels on important drugs and medicine. I studied at Rutgers, as you mentioned in your kind introduction, Susan. After Rutgers, I worked in many types of communication agencies and public relations, patient education, et cetera. I worked at several pharmaceutical companies. I had a family along the way, and this is an old picture. If it comes up, my husband, Rob, and my three kids, Alex, Michael, twins, and my daughter, Madeline. I took a very long journey to get my master's in public health. 6 years it took me. I almost gave up because I had to do it part-time and I had to pause and have babies along the way. And lastly, my most recent job before this one, we moved our family during the pandemic to Sweden, where I was the CEO and managing director of our affiliate there. So it's been a great experience. And how I got here, though, is I asked the question, hey, in 135 years, how come we've never had a woman run Latin America? And that question kind of prompted a little bit of why I'm here.
What was the first reaction when you asked the question?
It was a great reaction. It was, you're right. They hadn't thought about it.
Well, that tells you a lot right there.
It tells you a lot. But it's not only just about asking the question. I think it's, you know, had we not raised our hands before, I don't know. I don't know what the history was. I'm relatively new to Merck. I've been there since 2016. But it took a lot of work to build sponsorship and advocacy to get here. And I want to make sure that that's something that all women take away as we talk today. It's not enough to work hard. You have to articulate what it is you want and be comfortable saying that. So I think that's important in me asking those prompting questions.
I think that's so important because I grew up in a different era and they were really hard questions to ask and it took me a very long time to be able to ask those questions. And so I think what you're saying is so important for all of you to be able to just start off asking those questions. Obviously, you need to build credibility. So when you had your children, did you take time off? How did you handle and juggle all of this, Sarah?
It's been difficult. I will say the way that we all struggle with work-life balance, it's not just a woman's issue, right? But women struggle a little bit more because, especially in the Americas, we bear a heavier burden. We're expected to be caregivers, not just for our children, but also for our parents, right? So it helps to have a really strong partnership, strong support network, and have a great partner. For example, when we moved to Sweden, and that's a picture of me and our pillbox in the Swedish affiliate, my husband decided to take a permanent sabbatical. He was in compliance at Citibank, and he said, you know what? It's important for you and our family. Let's do it. Let's take this and since we've moved back, he's the primary caregiver, taking the kids to school, the activities, making their lunches. It works for our family. I'm not saying it will work for everyone, but you have to have a strong partner that's willing to be there with you.
Congratulations for finding a strong partner. encouraging to do that. So, you know, what are your values? I mean, what do you think is the most important dimension to your values, and what do you advocate?
Thank you. So I have many values that I stand for and with, or that make me who I am. One is empathy, right? Leading with empathy, integrity, authenticity. I think as women, too, we struggle with being who we are and being ourselves and showing vulnerability, so that's important as well. Humility, you don't need a title to be a leader, and that's really important. And when you get a title, if you're, you know, if you work your way and you have that privilege, then it's a huge responsibility, and it makes you, you have to remind yourself to stay humble, because power is fleeting, right? And the impact that you have on the people that work with you and alongside you and for you, that's really what should give you energy, not chasing the title, right? So those are some of the values that really resonate with me.
And how do you encourage humility among your team?
Well, it's a great question. We should ask them. I think for us, it's leading with gratitude. And I think we've done a really nice job of always recognizing the work that we do and being humble, right, in who we are. So that would be one way, is to really always
recognize your leadership style, humble, assertive. How do you lead?
So my leadership style is adaptive leadership. And if the slides were working, you'll see that come up shortly. There's a little bit of a lag. But I encourage all of you to take a look at TED Talks. There's a great talk by Rosalind Torres, also Latina. And she talks about leading in the 21st century and adaptive leadership. And that's really navigating the external network that you operate in, right? Self-correcting, taking feedback, and changing course, right? If you get feedback that something that you're doing is not the right way to do it, listen to that feedback and course correct. Finding those win-wins is another way. So I think it's all about being this adaptive leader, and what made you successful before is not gonna work everywhere, right? So what made me successful before, I had to completely adapt in Sweden, an entirely new culture. I didn't speak the language. If I had come in as an American, as a Latina from Newark, that would never have worked. Same coming back, right? I had actually become more Swedish. And when I came back, I had to readapt and reintegrate. So I think that's part of that. I encourage you, all of you, to watch that TED Talk. It's really inspiring.
How did you become more Swedish? What are the characteristics of being more Swedish?
It's actually, it comes to work-life balance. That's one thing that I take away. The Swedish people, they're so great, and they really value their work-life balance. And they take the entire month of July off. Can you imagine doing that? And I mean off, not checking emails, not. And it's so valuable because they really value the time with their families, and it's so important to do that. So since I've come back, and my team knows, if I'm out of office, I really try not to bother anyone on the weekends or on the evenings. Absolutely not. That's your time. Nothing that I'm going to send you unless it's a fire is that important that you should respond to me, right?
This is off target, but I'd really love to get your response. Sweden has a real social safety net, and it's something that, frankly, is under discussion in this country all the time, and it's certainly one of the most important headlines across Latin America, as we see a number of leaders being elected that are really being elected on that platform. And so does that make your life in Sweden easier? I mean, are people more tranquil because they believe and can manage work-life balance because they believe somebody's got their back?
I think so. I think it's a great question, actually, Susan, because even take maternity leave. You know how we fight for that in the U.S.? In Sweden, both partners can take up to a year subsidized, and you know you have the confidence to go back to your job. Can you imagine that? When I first had my twins, I had just started at a company. They were progressive in that they hired me while I was pregnant, so very progressive, but I didn't have leave. They were born premature, 7 weeks early, 3 weeks in the hospital, and I had to go back 1 month later. Right? Can you imagine? So that's heartbreaking, but it's a reality for most women in US. So that social net of healthcare, of daycare for children, of protection of labor laws, I think that is really what makes, I think, the Swedish people quite tranquil.
Thank you. So you're a woman, you're Hispanic. Have you faced bias, and how have you addressed that part of your challenge?
So all the time, every day. Some examples. I was once assigned a mentor at a prior company, and I was trying to articulate, okay, this is what I'd like to do, this is my ambition. And he said to me, you know what, why don't you go home and take care of your kids? That's what he said. And so what did I do? I got a different mentor, you know? So what is that? And I just thought, would anyone ever say that to a man? Or, you know? So that was one example. Recently, very recently, I also was in the experienced some bias where I had to say no to a business trip for personal reasons, which it's important that we set boundaries, especially when it comes to family. And I received a little bit of, well, what signal are you gonna send? And what about your reputation? I said, well, my reputation's intact because I'm prioritizing the right thing, which is my family. So I think it's important, coming back to your question on the values, know what your values are and what your non-negotiables are, right? Because that is you. You need to protect you, and that has to be a really strong foundation when you face bias. I think the last comment I'll make, and it's taken me a long time to be here, is that bias is never about you. It's about the person. And I'm sorry if they've come from a different lens or where that's from. It's often insecurity. But it's a lot of energy and power that you draw away from yourself to unpack someone else's view, right? So be judicious about when you do that. If it's a manager and you have to coach them on the bias, that's one thing. But if it's someone else that really isn't worth the time, don't bother. You're never going to change their opinion. Stand strong in what you believe in. And I think that's a way to address the bias.
I think that's a really, really important comment. And this idea that, and clearly the most important idea, that you really need to prioritize your family and what you need from a personal perspective, that's critical. And I think, for me, it took me way too long to figure it out. But I think that for the generation of many of you sitting in the audience, as Sarah said, this is something you have to prioritize immediately. Not to say that you don't have to show up at work, but you've got to create priorities to be able to go forward. So you talked a little bit about humility. What other attributes have been important for your career? And maybe you could talk a little bit, because, you know, you've been at Merck since 2016, you were an outside hire, you were, you know, a Hispanic woman. How did you get on that journey? How did you find Merck, or how did Merck find you?
Well, it comes down actually to building a strong network. So there's another COA in my life, not just the Council of the Americas, but my personal council of advisors. It's so important that you build that internal and external network that you can count on. So on the way to work, I'll call a former manager. We have a book club, which is a group of very senior women from many multinational companies that get together a couple times a year. We vent, we share advice. You need that network and that support to help you on your journey to building advocacy and finding opportunities. So how I got to Merck was a former manager. I ran into him at a conference on a plane, and he said, this is what I'm doing at Merck. Let's have coffee. And that's how it started.
That's really interesting and really cool. And a great piece of advice. Always talk to who's sitting next to you on the train.
Yeah, or the plane or anything like that. You never know where opportunities arise. I think the one other comment, Susan, and you asked about attributes. I think it's important as well to identify not just your strengths, but articulate them as superpowers. What makes you, you, right? That is unique to you. That is a superpower. Identify, come up with your short list, and then get comfortable articulating that. also get comfortable being uncomfortable. As women leaders, we are constantly uncomfortable. You have to get comfortable with that, because it stretches you, it grows you. You'll make mistakes, you'll be vulnerable, but you learn so much along the way.
So generally, women are less good, or not very good at all, in articulating their attributes and what makes them who they are and being successful. So what advice do you have when you're talking to women or mentoring a woman and you say, this is what you need to do? How do you get them to gather their energy and feel confident?
We practice. So what I like to do is picture yourself on an elevator. You have three floors. You run into the CEO of the company. That's what, I don't know how many seconds that is. So you have that many seconds to tell that person who you are, what you've done, what you're doing now, and where you're going. And practice. So I think that's one way to help us articulate, again, your superpowers, your strengths, your attributes, but also your ambition, if you have that ambition that you want to articulate. So that's one way that I try to coach. And I think it's so important that, again, we get comfortable articulating what it is we want. Not everyone can or wants to, you know, have all international careers or move up the ladder. By the way, I've taken several downward moves as well in my career to get the experiences. But it's all about getting comfortable voicing what it is you want.
Talk a little bit about downward steps in your career and why and how you decided to do that.
So the move to Sweden was actually the move to Merck was a downward move. It was with the opportunity to work on a blockbuster drug that revolutionized cancer treatment. It was worth it. And the move to Sweden was also a downward move. But for me, the experience zone, living in a foreign country, leading an organization, stretching myself in working in a different culture, and running a business. So it was worth it. And that's the trade-off that you have to make as an individual when you're looking at your career choices, right? What are the pros and cons of the different moves you make? And as I get older, I do so with intention. I want to be very intentional about that. Life is short. We have one race. I know it's the New York City Marathon this weekend. We have one race to run. So let's make it worth it.
I agree with that, although I don't think I could make it through the marathon.
Me neither. Not in these heels.
I'd need a hospital, an ambulance to pick me up. So, you know, you must have detractors. And so kind of who are they, and what do you say to them? Or what do you say to people that they may have made behind your back comments to?
Well, it's interesting. I've had people say to my face some very disheartening, demotivating comments. And unfortunately, they were senior women. And that's really disappointing. I remember it happened twice over breakfast, so maybe my learning is not to have breakfast with senior women. But in both instances, they said to me, in different versions of the story, were, you know, I can't believe they gave that job to you. Yes. And they should have given it to so-and-so. That person is much more experienced than you. So again, I come back to the bias. Now, I could have walked away, but I was hungry, and I was enjoying my breakfast up until that moment. And I realized how sad. But you know, at the same time, it's explainable. There's such few positions for women, unfortunately, in this day and age, that because of that, many feel that they're competing, and they have to put others down. So what I learned from that is never to do that to anyone, ever, first of all. But in the moment, I just deflected the conversation and turned it back. Well, what advice do you have for someone like me? If you don't see me in the role, I have it. Someone did believe in me. So what advice do you have? And it shifted the conversation. So that would be just some examples of the detractors that I faced in my career. And that wasn't that long ago.
So the first time you presented at your board of directors at Merck, or with the CEO, what was it like?
Well, I haven't had the privilege yet to present to the board of directors, but I have met the CEO. I've been privileged to do so, and it was, he's a very humble person, actually, as many of us know. And I was just myself. I explained who I was. I remember the elevator speech, who I was, what I've done, what I'm doing, and where I'm going. And it was a great conversation. So I'm privileged to have this role, and I'm grateful for it, and it's a blessing. I look at it as a blessing, but also a responsibility. And I made it clear that America Latina is a priority for us and our business, and it's a great contributor to Merck and the important work that we're doing. And I said, here's where we need your help to do better and to do more for our patients.
And who are your role models?
Well, actually, Susan, you and I didn't practice this, but you're one of mine. No, but she is. You know, when I first met you, and that also encouraged me to join the board and the Council of the Americas, I was so impressed by how you navigated, a room full of politicians, ambassadors, ministers, and she just does it in such a natural, relaxed style, and wow, she just commands the room. So that's...
Thank you.
No, she really is. You're one of my role models. But also my daughter, and I posted this on LinkedIn. She is in sixth grade. We have just put her in a school that's going to turn into an all-girls school with the hope that she can be more confident and not face some of the challenges that we faced growing up as women leaders. And I went to her back-to-school night, and she had a picture where she had an exercise to define leadership. Here it is. Thank you. And this is my sixth grade daughter's view on, her name is Maddie, on leadership. Learn to love, to be happy. It's all done with, as an acronym, empathy, accept others, fight for what is right, right? Everyone shows leadership, responsibility, shape the world with faith and hope. I love that. Honesty is key to be a leader. Illuminate the world with intelligence and persistence. Kindness means friendship. So she's one of my role models.
That's great. I think that's so important. You know, many times in your careers, you will think, oh my gosh, I feel so guilty. I'm leaving my children at home and I'm going off to work or I'm going on a business trip. Well, you know, I now have a 35-year-old son and a 33-year-old daughter. And whenever there's an issue, it's me. And it's, you know, very much, it didn't affect them for 15 seconds. In fact, it helped create a different dimension. But you don't realize that when you're actually doing it and you're feeling guilty going on a business trip, that in fact, your kids will benefit from this, in my opinion. That's something, that's a learning that I took on as I got older. So how can we all help each other?
So I think it's important to take others with you on your journey. Lift each other up. If you see someone doing something well, tell them. I just did that last week. I ran into somebody who I had seen present months and months ago, but she had made such a positive impression on me that I said, before we get to all that, I just have to tell you, you did such a great job at presenting to us a few months ago. And you could see, like, wow, the energy. So do that for each other, regardless of female or male. Just do that for each other. Everyone could use a kind word, right? And invest the time and energy in yourself. And then, of course, share any learnings along the way. Representation matters. So if you're hiring, if you have the opportunity as a manager to hire, make sure that you have a diverse set of candidates and a diverse set of panelists interviewing for those positions. Right? Because otherwise we're not going to make any progress if everyone looks the same, right? And surround yourself with that different, diverse board of directors for yourself as well. Make sure that you infuse different perspectives because we all have blind spots, right? So that would be, those are some examples of how we can help each other.
So with that, I want to bring this amazing conversation to an end because my team has told me it's time to quit. So we need to move on to our next part of the agenda. I want to thank you, Sarah, for this amazing conversation. I think we've all learned a lot from it, and we look forward to continuing it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Susan. Thank you.
And
thank you, Sarah and Susan. That was amazing. What a great conversation. I'm going to definitely remember that. Shape the world with hope and faith. We will now continue our programming with our first panel discussion on the power of example, the impact of women's representation across industry. For this panel, I would like to welcome to the stage Jeannine Acevedo, a partner at White & Case, Ambassador Maria Nazaré Farani Acevedo, the Consul General of Brazil in New York, Michelle Gatson-Williams, Managing Director and Global Head of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion at BlackRock, and our moderator, Julian Carvalho, CEO Latin America, ex-Brazil and Mexico at Lazard. Julian, I'll pass it to you.
Thank you, Guillermo, and thank you to the American Society and the Council for having all of us this morning, and to you for joining us. Ladies, it's such a treat to have this space with you this morning to talk about the power of example and the impact of women's representation across industries. And I want to start with representation. What has it meant for you throughout your careers? And I'll start with you, Ambassador Lele.
Thank you, Julianne. Thank you, everyone, for being here. I feel very energized when I'm in a group like this, but full of women and few men, nothing against men. But Julianne, I think representation meant absolutely everything for me in my career. Maybe not for the reasons you're thinking of, but I've been around the block for a long time, and I started my career in the early 80s. And I remember the day that I read on the paper that the results of the exams to enter the diplomatic career were out. It was the beginning of the 80s, so you had to go personally, see if your name was on the list. So I took my car, went to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Brazil to check if my name was on the list. And my heart was pounding, I was very nervous. And when I got there, yes, my name is here on the list, and I was very happy. I turned around to go to the elevator, go home, tell my family, and I saw this woman coming in my direction. She was the wife of a very powerful ambassador at that time, and we socialized together, we played tennis together, so I opened my eyes, my arms very wide, and I smiled very largely from one ear to the other. And I said to her, I screamed in the corridor, I made it! And she just walked past me. She never stopped. And she said, as she was walking past me, she said, this career is not for women. And I, you know, my arms fell, my smile withered, and I thought, oh God, if this career is not for women, this has got to change. But I didn't become an activist immediately. No. I just realized it was like seeing a movie and looking at my life, the projection of my life, and I thought, oh my God, to be included, I want to be included. I want to be one of them. I want to belong to this group. So I will have to excel. So I panicked. Am I good enough? I have to do my best every day. Is my best good enough? And that was my north throughout my whole career. I was, you know, putting the best that I could so that I could be included. And if I were included, others would be included too. So 20 years down the road, I found myself sitting in the chair of that woman's husband's, well, in the that woman's husband's chair. Thank you. It was not planned. It was not a vengeance. She disappeared from my head and my thoughts. The only thing that stuck to me was the fact that I had to do my best every day. And I did it, and it paid off. And I was participating. I was as chief of cabinet, chef de cabinet, or chief of staff of the minister, I was the first woman to be nominated to that position. So I was sitting at the table, I was giving my opinion, and I was being listened to, and I made sure that in that position to pull other women up the ladder, but this is another story. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ambassador Lele. So how about you, Michelle? Representation.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. So similar to the ambassador, representation means everything. And I think for me, growing up in corporate America, I spent over 34 years in a number of different industries. I've lived outside of the United States for 2/3 of my career. I've lived in Switzerland for 10 years, Hong Kong for 5 years, Istanbul, Turkey for 3 years. I didn't necessarily see a lot of individuals who looked like me. And so, and I didn't see many individuals who looked like me in any capacity, even at the junior level all the way through to the boardroom. And so representation for me, it just means if I can see her, I can be her. And so seeing that role model allowed me to understand what was possible for me. And so I've just, over the years, have done everything that I possibly can to ensure that any individual, especially young women, that it is my indelible responsibility to ensure that she sees me, she hears me, she feels valued, and that I pull her along the journey. So I think this notion of representation, it means validation that we are here, that we are equally as talented. We just might need some additional support in order to get to our next, whatever that next is, that it illustrates what's possible, that it can be possible. You can sit in these boardrooms and assume and occupy these large-scale roles and manage billions of dollars in terms of revenue, that you can also break down stereotypes about who we are. And especially being a woman of color, there is this stereotype about us in terms of how we show up, how we engage, how we lead, and that will ultimately determine how we succeed. So representation means everything. And so I try to be as visible as I can. I try to, I don't roll up the drawbridge once I've crossed over to the other side in terms of leadership. And I would encourage all of us to do the same. Continue to ask for what we want. And I think one of the initial speakers said that, asking for what you want. And I think representation, we need to continue to ask for that and hire for that and have some goals around it and hold ourselves accountable to it.
Thank you, Michelle. It's inspiring. To me, that's what representation is. It makes me feel like I can continue to grow, that I can make it. Love listening to you. Jeannine, do you want to share a little bit about your experience and what it's been for you?
Yes, thank you. Very much like Michelle, representation is, to me, a way of visualizing, right? Once you see someone in a position that perhaps you just didn't imagine was a possibility for you, once you see someone in that position, it really helps reframe how you see your own career. And what are the possibilities? In terms of setting limitations for yourself, I certainly have set many limitations for myself that I later realized were just not real limitations. It's all in my head. Once I see someone who might look like me or share my values or have a similar background to me, I am able to then aspire to that. When I was a younger lawyer, I really didn't have that much, frankly. I always looked around the room and everyone sort of was the typical man. And so having the possibility even of being myself in the discussion was quite a challenge. If you're not surrounded or at least have the one person that you can look up to and have a role model and say, you know, she was able to do it, or that person was able to do it. Maybe I have permission to ask for those things, right? So representation to me is really about visualizing yourself in the position, as well as being able to feel like you're invited, like you have something to say here, because someone else has already done it. but generally.
Thank you, Jeannine. And I'll add two other comments to representation as I see this, you know, room full of women. To me, representation is also about your peers, about, you know, being able to commiserate, to ask for advice, to, you know, just feeling that sense of belonging in the room, which we, you know, I usually, when I think of representation and I automatically associate it with example and looking up. But as I was thinking about this panel, I'm like, you know, it's lonely. And it's just nice to have other, you know, women, other underrepresented groups in the workplace. And that belongs to all of us. Like, that is the power of the network, of building those relationships and being effective, because it, you know, it takes all of us. Ambassador Lele, I want to go, you know, you're our only government representative on this panel, and I'd like for you to tell us a little bit about what policies can incentivize greater women's leadership in the diplomatic world or in government service.
I like that question. I can bring in a governmental perspective, but I want to weigh in a woman's perspective too on this one. I think we all agree, or we could agree in this room, that governments set the example, or at least should set the example. If a government has a very diverse or inclusive policy, so others will follow suit. Corporate world, the universities, parliament, everybody will try to emulate the government's thresholds and examples. So in the case of Brazil, we have quotas for women, quotas for people of color, quotas for people with disability, and we can argue the pros and cons of quotas. I am in favor of quotas because I think it takes people out of their comfort zone. People get lazy. They like the status quo. So quota will give that push. So it's good to have quotas. But the thing that I ask myself very much is that enough? Is quota enough? We have quotas for so many things in Brazil. But it doesn't seem that in the case of women, it's not working. And then I come to my second point. When we look around, maybe even in this room, if we look around, women are everywhere. They are speaking their hearts. They are flying supersonic planes, not here in this room, but they are CEOs, they are prime ministers, they are whatever they want to be. They are even at home because it's their choice to be home. But when we look at these statistics and we look for the women, I don't think we are there yet. I don't think we have what to celebrate yet. When I look at these statistics and I see that women are, in most parts of the world, the main bread provider of their homes, but when they are home, they are victims of domestic violence. This is bad. Women, they are, at least in my country, they are occupying more than 50% of the university benches, but not the C-suite positions. And I saw in the papers that I read for this conference that I think around the world we are less than 25%. And then you look at political representation. Also in my country, and I think around the world, women are more than half of the electoral college, but we are voting in men because our representation in Congress is minimal. In my country, we have quota for women candidates. Then we have quota for the resources to finance the campaign of women, but our representation in Congress is still under 20%. So this is very, very low. But then my message, and I think the main question here is that, and I think Sarah addressed that, you have to raise your hand, you have to go get it. Nobody's questioning, at least publicly, that we have the right for certain positions. Today, no. When I started my career, yes, not today. So today we have to trust ourselves, we have to trust all the women and vote in them and allow them to progress. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. Michelle, I want to ask you about programmatic incentives and initiatives in corporates that, that can incentivize greater leadership from women. But actually, before we get there, I want to take advantage that you're here. And if you can give us a little bit of context and background on just the evolution of DEI in the workplace before we get to specific programmatic incentives or initiatives for greater leadership in women.
Yeah, and I've been leading DEI for 30 years, so I've seen a true evolution over the course of time. This conversation, the discourse around DEI has really evolved over the years. It's no longer this conversation about representation. It encompasses so much more than that. That's only about a third of what the conversation really is. It's about representation. It's about how are we serving our customers and clients and all of those types of things, given the fact that our customers have a different need, a different set of wants, and how are we accommodating all of those things. And then there's the foundation and charitable giving piece. So I think this notion of DE&I has evolved in a good way, because 30 years ago it was more of a headcount exercise. At least that's what it was when I started in it. It was how many women, how many people of color, and all of those kinds of things. So I think it's morphed into something that I think is a lot more comprehensive and fulsome. And so to answer the second part of your question, and I can talk about the organization that I represent. So I work for an asset manager, BlackRock. We are the largest asset manager in the world, 20,000 employees in over 30 countries. And we have goals and targets similar to government, where we're holding ourselves to a high bar. We're holding ourselves to a standard of representation of women. We want to double the number of women across the board overall, 50-50 gender split across all businesses, across all sectors. But we're also, we want to double the number of women in leadership. And so we're holding ourselves accountable to that. And every leader, every business function within our organization has a target. And that target is annualized, and you're being held accountable to that through the compensation and the performance management process. So if you're not adhering to the things that we're putting in place, if you're not principled around DE&I, there is a consequence to it. So we're not playing games here. We really are very steadfast and committed and intentional about what we're doing. And one mechanism to do that is through accountability, and that is through measurements, scorecarding, and all of those kinds of things. Now, I want to also, I think we can get women in the door. What you do with them while they're in the door is really at the heart of the conversation. Do they feel valued? Is there a clear career path? Do they see role models and other individuals like themselves so they can see the art of the possible? I think that is what most organizations, either in public sector or private sector, that they wrestle with. And so, in any case, I think that's also part of the conversation is representation, but also retention, advancement, and some other things that we want to see happen long term.
Jeannine, would you care to comment on some examples in the legal profession or that you've seen at White & Case to incentivize women to take on these leadership positions?
Yeah, absolutely. Just to give a few examples, our clients are asking for this. So if you're in the service industry, there is kind of the piece of we all need to work on this because it's the right thing to do. There's also the piece of it, in the United States at least, we have around 55% of law school students who graduate are women. So we have this talent pool. We are, hiring women in our lower ranks, and then we need to, invest in them and get them promoted as it's almost like an existential matter in terms of a long-term business. But in terms then of folks who kind of have a different view of the world and maybe sort of doing the right thing is kind of not that important. When you have a client such as BlackRock say, what are you doing? I want to see what is it that you're doing within your organization to improve your numbers. I think there's a lot of emphasis on, show me the data. And it's creating a real impact, at least from the service industry perspective. White & Case, for example, has gotten Mansfield Rule certification, which requires that a certain number of women have been promoted and are part of the global partnership. At this point, we're 22% of women partners, and for a law firm, these are the owners of the business. So it's actually, you know, very important. And then that sets down sort of the message for the rest of the individual teams as well. There are other things that are incredibly important and which have actually helped a lot in my personal career. Internal networks, a lot of this is sort of formalized where the firm says, okay, we're gonna kind of pair you up, we're gonna have mentorship programs and programming to kind of help develop skill sets, not just on the actual work that you do, but how about, let's have a chat about how is it that you can do networking outside of the firm? How is it that you can, you know, establish a presence when you're engaging in public speaking, for example? And all of those things kind of paired together, I think, are incredibly important for the questions of, you know, what is it that we can do in terms of retention of women over a long term?
Thank you, Jeannine. I want to stay with you and Michelle to talk a little bit about inclusive culture. I'm a big fan of the Maslow pyramid. Basically, it's the pyramid of needs, where to practice at the top of your license, to be in the zone, to, you know, when you're in that groove where you're you feel like you're really effective, that you're outperforming, you know, assuming you're basic needs are met, what they really highlight are two things. Is one, the sense of belonging to the place where you're working, and the second one is that your opinion is valued, that you have, you know, that you have a seat at the table, that you have something to add. And you often see underperformers in one company that go on to do extremely well at a different company. And that a lot of that has to do with, you know, a different company being able to, you know, leverage their abilities to really help them be able to practice at the top of their license. Have you seen in your experience a link between inclusive culture and employee motivation, productivity, retention? Can you talk a little bit about that?
I think they're all intertwined. And I think that in order for women, people of color, whatever the dimension of diversity you represent, in order to be successful, we as organizations cannot leave you to your own devices to figure out how you're going to be successful. We have to put in support systems, mechanisms for you to be successful. And this is where sponsors and mentorship programs come into play. Leadership development opportunities come into play. And so I think it's more about understanding that we are all not a monolith, that there are some things that we need to provide in order for individuals to be successful. Flexible working arrangements, especially coming out of the pandemic, this notion of hybrid working is something that is discussed regularly in our organization through our women's network. They want flexible working, so we have a hybrid model of 3 in, 2 out. You come into the office 3 days a week, you work remotely 2 days a week, we don't care how you do it, as long as you do it. So I think it's those types of support systems that's really going to support women to become more productive, more innovative, more collaborative, now that we're starting to come back in office. So I think it's an aggregation of all of those things that are going to ensure that women are successful.
I mean, who likes to belong to a club that doesn't want you as a member of the club? I certainly don't. I mean, I think I'm an example. You know, I don't think that I would have achieved what I have achieved. And frankly, like, being a lawyer is already pretty hard. And kind of our clients, some of them are lovely and some of them are not. I love them all. I love them all. But you just need to feel that support, right? You really need to get the training. You need to feel like you're valued, because, you know, I'm sure this room is full of very talented people who are very smart and very accomplished. if you are not feeling valued within your organization, what is it that you're going to do? You're going to exit, and you're going to take those skills and go to a competitor. So even just from a like a business sense, it doesn't make sense to not work towards building that inclusive environment that is supportive. Because, I mean, again, from the perspective of the service industry, we hire amazing students, we spend a lot of time and effort and resources in training them, and then a couple of years later, they leave. That is not good business, right? That is not good service for our clients. The best that we can hope for is that even if someone wants to leave the organization because of family reasons, you know, life happens, they will walk away from White & Case feeling like, you know, that was a great place to work. I learned a lot. I was supported. And if I move on to a different place, maybe I come back as a client. And I'm sure that, you know, the law firm experience is not unique, right? So this idea of, you know, we all need to work towards an inclusive environment where we feel valued, where there are opportunities for promotion, and all of those things, it's the right thing to do, but also makes just a lot of business sense.
If I can just pile on to that comment for a second. I always say that, especially in corporate, there are some individuals who have an easy go of it and who can take the proverbial elevator up to the C-suite, right? And then others have a different path. They have to take the stairs with a backpack and no air conditioning, and then when they get to the top of the stairs, the door is locked. So the question becomes, who's going to open that door, right? Who's going to open the door for us? And I think this is where sponsors, mentors, this is where male allies come into play. And so when we talk about support systems, that's what I mean. It's who's going to have our back? Now that you're there, now that you're occupying the seat, you're going to need support. So it's women supporting women, it's male allyship, it's mentor, sponsor, all of it. So that's what I mean by support systems.
Thank you, Michelle, because you brought me to my next question. To me, the power of example is not only about female examples, it's also about the examples that men can set. For the women, for their male colleagues as well. And I want to talk about this with you, Ambassador. You know, from your perspective, you know, what roles can men play in supporting diversity, equity, and inclusion efforts?
First, I want to comment on what they just said, because
please.
I want to move to the corporate world. You're very nice people. I loved it. Well, about men, I think my first comment is be at ease. Men are not our enemies, the first thing, yes. They are our allies. And I think it's simple. It's as simple as that. It starts at home. If we pass on to our boys the right values, they will become, as they grow up, our advocates, our supporters, etc. But they will become that. And the present world is another world. And I think this world is a world where man is overrepresented in many circles, in many decision-making circles. And we don't expect from these men only advocacy and support. We expect them to do things, to remove the obstacles, to allow us to advance our own careers, your careers, and give a chance to women. So we want proactive men. We want role models. And sometimes these role models, they take, you know, it's all about big decisions or small day-to-day decisions. I remember a few years ago that my husband was director general of the WTO. He was invited to a traditional lunch on in Geneva. And when he received the invitation, it was a male-only lunch on. So he didn't hesitate. He got the phone, he called the organizers, and he said, well, I'm having a hard time accepting this invitation because of this and that. And they revealed the rule. And from then on, this is a lunch on for men and women. It's a small decision, but it makes a difference. And well, for Roberto, it was easy because he's the father of two girls and the granddad of six granddaughters. So he has to be a role model. Yes. And I like when he says that men have to be role model for women and for the family, because if you break barriers, if you are a good role model, this transcends generations, and I believe that. Thank you. I think.
Stop here. I would not occupy the seat that I have at BlackRock or any other multinational that I've worked for over the years had it not been for male allyship. Had it not been for the mentors and sponsors who had nothing but my back, who had nothing but my best interest. So I agree with you. DEI is about the collective we. It's not just about women. It's about all of us. And we all have a role to play. And you talked about championship, advocacy, and all of those things. We need more of that because it's still hard. It's still difficult. And the air is still thin at the top of these organizations, including government. So I think there is an intentional, deliberate role that our men have to play in order for there to be equity, parity, and fairness, and fair outcomes for women in these organizations.
No, I love I've had fantastic mentors and champions as well throughout my career, and it's like, it's not only about like you pushing up, it's really important for the men who do like this and pull you up as well. And a lot of that has to do with you, with cultivating the networks, cultivating the relationships, the mentorship. And it's a two-way street. It's not only about them just miraculously, coming in and pulling you up. You've got to push up too and, put on your backpack and go up the stairs.
So my experience is exactly the same. Like I said earlier, growing up as a young lawyer, I really didn't have any women that were there to do that for me. Some people say you've been kind of very lucky that I ended up working with a fantastic group of men who have supported me. I just don't want to say that it's pure luck. I think I've also worked quite hard in building those relationships with the men who have supported me. And I like what you just said. It's very much a two-way street, right? I have their back as, someone who is younger than them, and they have equally demonstrated that they have my back with that very active sponsorship, giving me opportunities to kind of be present in front of clients and take on leading roles so that even my visibility is enhanced. I really have to give a lot of credit to the men who have supported my career.
One of the things that I've also found really interesting in my conversations with the men is, and we're talking about it earlier, is asking for what you want or asking for what you need. So when you see something happen as a woman and you say, feeling comfortable enough to say, this is not okay, this is not okay with me, to have the conversation with your male colleagues or your mentor and say, I really need your support. When things like this happen with a client or a counterparty or a colleague, I also need you to have my back. I need you to say, this is not okay. Sometimes when a comment is made, you're like discombobulated. You can't believe you just heard that. And you have to ask them to have your back, to step in and say, hey, this is not okay. Or did I hear you correctly? Did you actually say that? And usually they'll say, yeah. And you're like, that's not fine. That's not okay. And the men need to feel comfortable stepping in. But also you as a woman need to ask for that or empower them to do that. And it just makes the experience better for everybody. There's a great saying in Spanish that says, el que calla, otorga. So like if you become an accomplice when you see something happen and you don't say anything. And there's ways and ways of saying things.
To that point, going back to the issue of women representation, one of the things that happened once I was promoted is that I was actually given a microphone. So when I see things like that and you know, in building the relationship with the wonderful men I work with, I actually am typically the one who say that's not okay. This needs to change because mistakes were made in my career in the past and we're gonna do things differently. And I'm there. I'm there to actually say those things, and they're there to actually hear me, which is just incredibly important. It's kind of the two-way street.
Right? Absolutely.
So this notion of being covered and having male allyship, and I just want to share a brief story, if
please.
I may. Years ago, when I worked in the pharmaceutical industry, I worked for a company leading diversity in practice, and I received a death threat from an employee. I went home on a Friday evening, and this individual slipped a note under my door, and it had the N-word, mm-hmm. yeah, all over the page, thousands of times, with red, like, fingerprints, almost like blood prints on a page. And, of course, as a young executive, I was, you know, I was scared. I was horrified, scared, and all of those things. Had it not been for my male allies, who basically said, I have your back. We will walk you to your car every night. You will be protected. We are here to protect you. And my CEO, who was a male at the time, also said the same thing. I felt covered. I felt protected. And as a matter of fact, I doubled down on my courage to do the work that I was doing, because what I was doing essentially was helping the workplace become better. And someone didn't necessarily like what I was doing. But I felt covered and protected because my male allies stood up for me and said, we've got you. Don't be afraid. We will walk you to your car every night and make sure that you are protected. That's the kind of covering, that's the kind of advocacy and championship that we need, because things happen. So I just share all of that to say, had it not been for male allies, at least in my career, I don't think I would occupy the seat that I currently have.
Well, and your male allies saying, you belong here. Your opinion
Absolutely.
Matters. The yep. work that you're doing matters. We will protect you.
We see you. We're going to protect you.
Correct.
And that meant the world to me.
That sense of belonging. And you were able to practice at the top of your license to rock it, to, you know, you are where you are today because they had your back. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that, Michelle. Let's pivot a little bit about to go into sort of impact that greater representation can have on future generations. Let's talk a little bit about barriers to representation and the importance of building a pipeline. I'll start with you, Ambassador. I mean, in the diplomatic world, and I always hear about the Foreign Service exam in the US, which is very scary. I'm sure you had to sit through something similar in Brazil. Do you want to share a little bit about what your experience has been like and your thoughts on barriers to representation and the importance of having greater gender representation for, as an example, and for future generations?
I think example is everything. You mentioned the exam. Yes, the exam to enter the career is very selective. Out of 1,000, few will make it. But I believe that in our case, in the case of the diplomatic career, we look at each other. We look at other women. When I said that I worked very hard, that I made it, et cetera, I did not do anything alone. I was, you know, I had my colleagues, I had my network, I had the supporters, and I think this is what matters. You are not in it alone. You have to be together. In Geneva, when I was representing Brazil at the UN in Geneva, we created something that some of you will not understand because it was. The title is very bold. It's the Lipstick Club. We got together the whole of all the women ambassadors. We decided that we should support each other. So we started going to each other's functions to favor each other's initiative, and it worked marvelously. Men, our colleagues, our ambassadors, the men, they were very jealous of us. But that was not our objective. The objective was to support each other, to advance each other's careers, and to give an example to the younger diplomats that were coming to Geneva. And this group still exists. It was founded in 2009. Today it's called a band of sisters.
In terms of barriers, I think sometimes we get in our own way. We can be our own worst critics, self-critics. We do this self-talk about what's not possible, I can't do, or that imposter syndrome that we all talk about all the time. Sometimes I think we are our own barriers to success. And I'm here to say, I was a young black girl from New Jersey who had big dreams and aspirations. And, you know, I was told many times that that's not possible, that you have the audacity to dream big. And I'm here to tell you, anything and everything is possible. And I think to your point, it's the role modeling, it's the representation, it's looking up and seeing someone that reflected me in my community. That meant the world to me. So I think any and everything is possible, but we sometimes have to get out of our own way and negate that self, that talk, that negative internal talk.
I agree. I think, and maybe this is kind of a more recent phenomenon perhaps, but I think we're kind of resting on our laurels. I think that there is a sense that it's been done. Like D&I, thank you, it's done, thank you, we did great. This is a sort of a continuing exercise and effort. And I would challenge all of you, in fact, within your organizations to keep at it, right? Because there are changes in the economy, you know, we all sort of answer to what's going on in the markets and clients and, you know, all of these other pressures. We can really lose sight of the importance of these issues. And for leaders who have a bajillion things on their heads, it's quite easy to say, well, in front of the 100 things that I need to do, I'm just gonna park this DE&I initiative with some HR person, and that's gonna be sufficient, and I can just put it in some, you know, info memo that I send out to the markets. That is simply not enough, and I would invite everyone in this room and everyone who is listening to kind of keep holding leaders' feet to the fire. This is important. The work is not done. The work is shifting. Like the nature of our discussions has evolved, as Michelle explained earlier, but it needs to keep going. There's just a lot more to do.
May I win it? No, I was. I liked Michelle's point about, you know, in our head, the barrier that stays here. Am I good enough? Should I raise my hand? Should I say this? And sometimes I feel that in the professionals of very new generations, those young professionals that are coming in the market, they feel very much sometimes entitled. Because, as you said, Jeannine, D&I is there. It has been solved for all of us. And in my head, I think that some women, when they see the first obstacle, because they come in the market and they think, oh, everything is worked out. I have the right to be there. And when they stumble in the first obstacle, they shy away, they go back. No, I believe that as you see and observe an obstacle, you should not go back. You should use this obstacle as a platform to go up and not think I'm entitled because DEI has been resolved. So this obstacle has to be removed by someone else. No, it has to be removed by you, by your own competence. So you should know your file, have an opinion, and be ready to be a competition. Because when you are a competition, those things will repeat in your life. So that's how I see these barriers. Use them as a platform to grow in your own career.
No, absolutely. DEI, if it's not front and tone from the top, front and center in the C-suite's agenda and accountability, you know, feet to the fire, it just gets, you know, put in a drawer and no change comes about. I have a ton of questions to continue to ask, but I've been, I need to open it to questions from the audience. Are there any questions?
Hi, can you hear me? Okay. My name is Marina. I work at Santander, and thank you for the panel, all of you. I heard once something that women don't typically have the same opportunities for networking because we don't often have the vertical networking that men often have. So we have peers, as we mentioned, which are great supporters, but maybe some of our peers are not able to provide us those opportunities, those career opportunities. Especially, you know, still in this day and age, I work in finance, men hang out at golf, and they do things, and, you know, good on them. They all love golf. But we don't often share necessarily the same hobbies or the same sort of social opportunities for doing that. So what advice would you have for specifically career networking when you don't necessarily have a lot of women above you who you could do that vertical networking with? How do you build that? So I guess that's my question.
I'll start. I don't play golf at all. my husband does. But I never liked the game, and so I never turned down a lunch invitation, an early dinner invitation. I will network the hell out of a room. So I think you have to use other mechanisms in order to get to and to cultivate and foster those relationships that you want. One of the things that I've done over the years is I enjoy just the art of discussion, and so I would just extend myself, even in a casual way, to a stranger. If there was some leader who had a skill, a capability, some magic that I didn't necessarily see in myself, I would reach out to them, ask them or invite them for, do you have a few minutes for coffee or whatever the case is? And I would utilize that 30 minutes to my advantage. And so I would say use other things, other mechanisms to be able to foster, cultivate, maintain, and sustain those relationships.
I'll add on to that, Michelle. I'm actually an introvert. I don't have your personality to work the hell out of a room. Absolutely not. I think you need to start looking at networking as part of your job description too. I find that women feel guilty about standing up from their desks and going to a luncheon or leaving early to have drinks. So, you know, start thinking about it more methodically, more strategically, and as part of one of the things that you have to do, like put it on your to-do list. It'll make you get up from your desk and let go of the guilt. Think of it as part of your job description. Also, with what Michelle was saying is find what works for you. As an introvert, a room full of people is very difficult for me, but those one-on-one conversations, reaching out to people, finding the spaces to create connections, because then people remember not what you said to them, but how you made them feel. So as you create those connections, you know, they'll introduce you to other people and you will find your own style of networking. And lastly, on the golf specific point, there's really great poker training now. So there's other things that also put you in that sort of more male space. And come, I'll send you the poker information. Come look for me in the end.
So I completely agree. One way to kickstart, number one, I will repeat your name because Marina from Santander, I think you all need to go and meet Marina. This room right here is great, right? And you should all kind of take the opportunity to speak to each other. Be the one inviting, right? If you kind of just wait for people to invite you, you won't necessarily get invited, not because they don't want to, but maybe because they forget. So if you're the one who is extending the coffee, you know, let's have a coffee, let's meet, you know, for an early dinner. I'm traveling and, you know, I'm going to be in your city. I would love to catch up and just get to, and just that way you kind of take it into your own hands. You're not waiting for other people to do anything for you.
I think you're working the room very nicely, Julianne. So empower yourself. I think Mariana mentioned golf. If you like golf, Mariana, create your own golf team with women, other women. But you know, you don't need to emulate, you know, men's ways of networking. I agree with everything that was said here. I think each one of us has to find her comfort zone and what works for her and do the best that she can. But I believe that we women sometimes are very, we are very rigorous with ourselves. Men, they talk about anything. They love talking about, you know, things that has nothing to do with work and laugh a lot. But we women, we are afraid of going out and talking about, you know, the new products, new perfumes, our last shopping spree, or things like that. There's nothing wrong with that. This is our way, exchanging recipes. We are women. We have to continue being women. But we have, and we can be professionals too. So we have to come out of this disguise of ambassador, CEO, lawyer, and just be yourself. And that helps a lot.
Thank you, Ambassador. There was a question up here.
Yes, I want to combine the next two questions.
Okay.
I think I'll go quick. Michelle, you mentioned imposter syndrome. A lot of us deal with that. What was the experiences in your life, as well as how did you overcome them?
You know, it's interesting. I'm gonna take a page out of Melody Hobson's book. Melody's the CEO, co-CEO of Ariel Investments. I don't suffer from imposter syndrome. I never have. And that's not to say that I know everything that it took for me to get here. I know every painstaking situation. I know of the death threat. I know all of those things, and I'm very much aware of them. But I also know that I've worked pretty darn hard to get here. I know I've done all the extras. I know I've raised my hand for the tough assignments, that I've sat in rooms where I was the only or the other and was okay with how I showed up in those rooms. So there's no imposter syndrome here. There really isn't, and that's not arrogance at all. That's just confidence. And I've learned that from my mentors and sponsors that I've had over the years. So I really can't even answer the question, because that's just something that I will not own at all. And I know Melody Hobson, she and I talk frequently. She's of the same perspective, doesn't live here. I don't own that. I don't want any part of it. So I would say for those who do, think about, you know, how you got here. Right? What are some of the kinds of experiences that you've had to get you to where you are? You're occupying a seat because you deserve to have that seat. Intellectual horsepower is table stakes. You've done the extras. You have grit. You have smarts. You're talented. Own all of that. And just, you know, leverage your power. Lean into your power. That's the best that I can say about it.
There was another question?
Yes.
This is on. So I have a bit of a different question, swaying from D&I more towards leadership. And thanks to the four of you and to Sarah for sharing your stories, which are very inspiring. I think some of the themes that we've heard from a leadership standpoint are around confidence and drive and you know, standing up and saying, this is what I want, and going for it. And so the flip side of that is vulnerability, right? And mm-hmm. I think we all know that great leaders are able to show their vulnerability and build trust with their teams. And so I'm curious to hear your perspectives on, especially as female leaders, how you think about vulnerability and how you think about showing that side of you that isn't always confident and driven, or sorry, maybe not driven, but doesn't always show up knowing exactly what to say and very confident.
They say he who dares, dares greatly. And I've learned over the years to share my story. That's how we stretch, grow, and learn. And I will use myself as the protagonist to make a point, and I will become vulnerable. I'm sitting in a crowded room telling you about my death threat story. I just believe that that's a muscle that most leaders, at least the ones that I've worked for, that were incredibly successful, that's a muscle that they flexed. And so I will use myself as the protagonist to make a point. Because I believe in any situation, if there's a sandstorm, I'm going in, I just need a pair of goggles. So I will protect myself, but I also believe in true vulnerability, because I think that is how we make points, that is how we stretch, grow, and learn, and we share ourselves with others. And quite honestly, that's the human side of what leadership looks and feels like.
at least
it inspires when you see when you're humble, when you recognize that you have a gap, when you talk about the struggles that you're having, and you build a team around that, because it becomes a we, it's not an I. So in my experience, the more that you talk about your challenges, your gaps, you put that front and center in front of your team. You also need to give people an instruction manual as to how to interact with you and how to best do that. And I just find that it makes you a much more credible and inspiring leader when you put your vulnerabilities in front of the group. Yes, it does feel vulnerable and uncomfortable, but it makes you that much more effective as a leader. Going back to your imposter syndrome, and it's kind of related, there is a Bozoma St. John, there's a case study, and she's done a lot of speaking around this topic, and I'd highly suggest, if you look her up, that she's inspiring. She's done a great job.
So on the two things, I received an accolade a couple of years ago from my law school. I went to Columbia Law School, so for me it was like the pinnacle of, my career, full circle. It was wonderful. I had a speech prepared. I was just enjoying the moment. I got up to accept the award, and the first thing that came out of my mouth was like, "Oh, I don't know what I'm doing here," and that those were the first words. I think I have imposter syndrome. Those were the first words that came out of my mouth. I think to a certain extent, as Michelle said, you're smart. You have achieved what you have achieved in life. You get to know yourself. To a certain extent, you need to trust that when you're kind of going into a room, into a negotiation, a presentation, you've done your homework. You're the most prepared in the entire room. And you know what? Someone gave you a microphone for a reason. Someone must believe in you because you're here. And that person who believes in you has to be you as well. So that chatter that is kind of in the back of your head needs to come down. It's very difficult for a young person. And it's very easy for me to say these things to you at my age, because I know who I am at this point. You just need to keep at it, keep trusting that your hard work and you doing all of these other things in the networking is going to really pay off. As to vulnerability, I spent probably the first 10 years of my career hiding the fact that I have 3 children, and like I have all of this hang-ups and stresses in my life, and I worked ridiculous hours, and it's like, oh my God, Jeannine, like, she said she must be insane and all of the chatter. And you know what? At this point, my superpower is the fact that, yes, I have achieved this. I have a family. I am happily married. And I am still here, right? But I bring those experiences. I would even dare to say the word compassion to my everyday, because I remember what it's like to be a young person kind of struggling at it and, thinking through, like, what am I doing sitting around the world? There are people who do not need to know facts about me. But that is an expression of vulnerability that you can really, kind of channel to, good use, if that makes sense.
Let me address vulnerability first. There are, in my opinion, many levels of vulnerability, and there's nothing wrong in showing vulnerability. If you listen to a dissenting opinion and you agree to that and you change your opinion because you heard something different than that idea that you had proposed, there's nothing wrong. This is not being vulnerable. This is being a good leader. So there are many levels. If you're vulnerable to a point of creating a disturbance, then you need help. But there are many levels of vulnerability. And being yourself, there's nothing wrong. To your question, I am here, sitting here, and wondering, why was I invited to what contribution do I have? And this has been my whole life. Every time I've been invited to do something or I have a task, I ask the same question. am I good enough? It doesn't matter, I go and I do it, and I do my best. If people like it, so good. If I like it, even better. That's it.
I think that with that, thank you, Ambassador. Thank you, Michelle. Thank you, Jeannine, for joining me this morning. It's been great. Thank you for listening. And thank you for the Council of the Americas for hosting us.
All right, thank you, Jeannine, Ambassador, Michelle, and Julianne. That was an amazing conversation. I have a big announcement, so now we're gonna move to a 30-minute coffee break and networking break in the room next door. We kindly ask you that you leave the room and please take your belongings so the waiters can set up for lunch. When we come back from the coffee break, we encourage everyone to sit at a different table so you get a chance to network with others. We will also have reserved seats for table leaders and special guests at each table. Enjoy the coffee break.
imaginamos por lo injusto del progreso, invisibles a las selvas de cemento, más vida sin ellos no hay, protectores los saberes del pasado, más vida sin ellos no hay. Thank you.
por cuya razón razón forzosa tengo un hijo que es mi tío. Por cuya razón forzosa tengo un hijo que es mi tío. Siendo mi hija sabido, la hija de mi mujer naturalmente de ser yo el hijo de su marido. Padre querido, y su mujer es mi madre, y aunque mi pecho taladre,
salta perico mi tío.
Él es mi hijo inocente, y mi tío naturalmente, porque hermano es de mi padre, y mi tío naturalmente, porque hermano es de mi padre.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back. Please take a seat. We're going to begin soon. Restart soon. All right, welcome back, everybody. I hope you enjoy the break. We're going to begin. Welcome back. All right, we're going to now continue our programming. Thank you. We will now continue our programming with our second panel, Finding Fulfillment in Reshaping Your Career Path. So please help me welcome to the stage Pippa Scarlett, head of Global Government Affairs at RELEX. Welcome, Pippa. Rafa Chavez, Executive Director of Global Policy, Government Affairs, and ESG at Organon. Noor Cristiani, head of Latin America Investment Strategy at JP Morgan Private Bank. And our moderator, Shelly Banjo, New York Bureau's Chief for Bloomberg. Shelly.
Thank you. Can you guys all hear us? Or me? Wonderful.
I'm just gonna move that around.
Great. Well, it's so nice to see you guys. Thank you so much for having us. This has been wonderful so far with the earlier panel. I love the parts about being authentic and being your authentic self. It really resonates with me. For this panel, we're gonna talk a little bit about career changes, and this idea that we've all just gone through quite a big upheaval over the last few years. The nature of work is changing, where people are working is changing, and we wanted to talk a little bit about reimagining, you know, and reshaping your career path. So, Pippa, why don't we start a little bit with you? Talk a little bit about kind of taking some risks. I know you changed jobs in the midst of the pandemic, and kind of how you think about evaluating those risks throughout your career. You've done so many different things.
Does it work?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Shelly. I love your name, Shelly Banjo. It's amazing. Pippa Scarlett. Yes. I guess I'll start with, I was reflecting on this. And first of all, it feels so nice and cozy here. It's a great vibe after all of us being under a shell or whatever for the last 2.5 years. So thank you to this organization and setting. I guess I've reflecting a little bit on the question. I guess I've been a bit of a risk taker quite a long part of my life. When I was in high school, a guy I was dating, whatever, when you're 16, he was like, hey, why don't you join the wrestling team? And I was like, okay. So I showed up to join the wrestling team at my high school, which was Division One, and much to my surprise, there were two other women, or I guess young women, who joined at the same time, and we all kind of looked at each other. We're like, "Hey, what's up?" But I wrestled boys, and I beat them. So that was part of my early experience that I was like, "Huh, well, let me just try." So I guess just a little piece of just who I am. I guess I've tried to find my center, to go back to some of the comments of the previous panel, to have a sense of what are my values, what are the things, and have that as my anchor. A little bit of serendipity also goes a long way. I would say perhaps the most dramatic I'm a lawyer, Columbia Law School grad, and I was in private practice also as a litigator, and when Barack Obama was elected president, I was like, wow, I want to have a chance to be a part of history. And but I had my babies first, so in his first term. And when he was reelected, I said, well, this is the only chance if I'm going to go for it, to, because he will not be elected a third time. And I made that jump from private practice to working at the U.S. Department of Justice and then later at the White House. And that was a big shift, and then a shift after that later. But it all starts from knowing yourself and having a little bit of confidence to go for it.
And after that, you went to Apple and then to your current role now. What kind of made you feel comfortable about taking those risks about government and then big company and then, you know, slightly smaller but global company as well?
I think what has inspired me is wanting to make an impact at scale and with leadership that I admire. So those are the things that I that would drive me to go into government at that time. And Apple is kind of like a country in a lot of ways in terms of its impact, supply chain, purchasing power, brand, all of that, and also with leadership that I admired. Where I am now, Relex, it's kind of the opposite of, it's not a consumer-facing brand, but every time you log in to do your online banking, you're using us, so we're all B2B. And again, a global, it's like a United Nations organization. People are literally from all over the world, and that's the way I was raised. I grew up all over the world, a child of career diplomats, ambassador, was reflecting on your comments. So that was a big part of why I wanted to be a part of a global organization that feels like the United Nations.
Great. Rafa, how about you? What do you think was so important throughout your career about taking risks?
So first of all, I'm not Aaron, right? Aaron was, obviously I'm not. He's handsome, I'm kind of not. But he was feeling sick this morning, and I told him, listen, you might be a threat to public health, so stay at home. I'll fill in. So thank you to the council for you know, inviting us to participate, and I'm extremely happy to be representing an ally in this panel. And when I was, you know, listening to Sarah and some of the previous, you know, speakers, panelists, you know, the first thing that I thought about was I'm here because of a lot of women right in my life. I'm here because, of course, of many of you, and some of those women that are here. So thank you, because you've taught me how to be a good ally, right? And that's why I'm here. So, but back to your question, I think, and someone talked about it in a previous session, but it's really following your passion, right? When you have a clear passion, and it doesn't have to be always moving up the ladder, right? So we heard this morning, it is okay to move to look for lateral moves. It is okay to gather you know, experience and to live, experience at doing many different jobs. So if you follow a passion, I think that needs to be the trigger for career change and for taking the risk. And that goes very close to always driving or aspiring to be a better self, right? And again, this was also brought up, you know, in our previous conversation. I love Sarah's point on articulate your superpower, right? Yeah, find that superpower, right? Follow it. Follow through, and then the rest will be behind your back. I mean, you will be looking at how to make change, you know, into the future. Yeah,
I think that's great, and also kind of this realization that it's not forever. Like, you take the risk, you see how it goes. If it doesn't change in a few years, you do something else. Like, it's not this big, feels really monumental at the time, and then you think you can actually maybe shift if it doesn't work out the way you want. Noor, how about you? What, tell us about some of the big risks that you took in your career and why you think they paid off for you.
I honestly don't know why I'm here.
I'm listening to these guys. I feel totally humbled. Thank you for inviting me. But honestly, I am the least risk-taking person that you will ever find. I'm an actuary. For those of you who don't know, I'm a mathematician. So I like things squared. I like things that I can control. Risks are usually not very controllable. So I'm not that much of a risk taker. That's the way that I think of myself. However, my life has been taking me into a direction that has forced me into change. Now, I'm not very good with change, clearly. So I struggle, but I've done it. And so I moved out of my parents' house very young to go to college, and then I took the chance to go to Europe sometime, and then to a job that was paying me very little, but that I thought, this is what I want to do. This is math, right? And I'm going to be paid like a fraction of what my friends are going to be making, and I'm going to have much less fun than what they are having. But, this is what I like. So I'm echoing Rafa's comments here regarding your passion. I think that one of the things that has always driven me forward and that I've had very clear throughout my career is, what is it that I like? What is it that I am passionate about? And I find myself, and I'm just going to tell you a little bit of my story. Summarized, I promise I won't take long. Past and current. I come from a family who had nothing. Like, literally, my dad was built out of nothing. He started from scratch. He was a construction worker in Mexico. So for those of you who know, it's not like a construction worker here. I mean, he was like really, really down below the ladder. And he came up and up and up through his own effort. Nothing was given to him. My dad says that he had two pairs of pants. One that he wore to go to school. Then he came back from school. He changed pants to his like work pants, and he went to work in the construction sites wherever he worked. And that was the way that he brought up his family, because he was responsible at the age of 10, 12 for his mom and his sister. So it was a huge example of how growth and how work takes you forward. So that's how I grew up, with that mindset. And the other thing is, my parents were never like, I went to a Catholic school back in Mexico, and so all my friends were like, yeah, we're so happy that we're gonna be making gâteau au chocolat, because I am very fluent in making gâteau au chocolat in French, but I had absolutely no idea how to do math, especially for going into a university like I did. And I was like, I don't wanna do gâteau au chocolat, I actually wanna do something. And so my parents were always very supportive of that. Like, you need to move forward, you need to pursue your passion. What is it that you like? And so that's where I come from. And then I realized that my passion is finance. So wherever I needed to do finance and markets, that's where I would go. And it's not, that was not a risk for me. That was my comfort zone. So regardless of what has happened, also what was happening around me, I was still thinking that I was within my comfort zone, because, it was markets at the end of the day. And now a little bit about my present. We just moved, my family and I, to New York. I have been based in Mexico doing markets, growing. Susan here knows me from a long time, like growing, always in Mexico, based in Mexico. I love Mexico. I was a Mexico equity strategist for our investment bank in JP Morgan for 11 years. Before that, I've been working in markets in Mexico for over 22 years in Mexico, right? So then this offer came to come to the US. I am married to a very successful man who has a very strong and successful professional career as well. And when the opportunity came for us to move to the US because of me, because of the offer that I was being given, I said no. And my husband, what he said is, you better say yes. And I was like, no way, I'm not gonna give up. For those of you in Latin America, we live much more comfortably than what we live here. And so, once again, I don't know what you invited me, guys, because I am the comfort zone. I need my driver, I need my nannies. Forget about your manicure, we're gonna move to the US. And I have two small children. And hearing you speak about allies, I think that one of the big things, the big reasons why I'm here and now, you know, I feel worthy of being invited here is that is because he pushed me into taking that risks, that risk. So one of the things that I think I wasn't here in the panels before, but that I, the, you know, what really changed my mindset is that sometimes it's not a matter of you finding the power within yourself, as Papi was saying, Pipa was saying, like, finding that within yourself. I mean, it's admirable that you are actually born with that. I hope I didn't, but I found someone who had it in him and pushed me to take that risk for the sake of my now largest passion. Markets have taken a second step. Now my largest passion is my family. And this was a good move for my family, and so we took the risk. So it's basically echoing what I'm hearing from these two amazing people in terms of pursuing your passions, following what you want, sticking to your values, how you grew up, and that's what's taken me here now.
What was the change? Like, you, he eventually wore you down, but what was the kind of tipping point?
My husband? Mm-hmm. I mean, you have to, I cannot describe him enough. If you sleep with this man every night, we need to move to New York. No, we're not moving to New York. No, we need to move to New York. No, I'm not, shut up, we're not moving to New York.
I mean, persistence.
Very. And when I asked him, how about you? You know, you're gonna be taking the largest risks. You're gonna be forfeiting your career. And I was like, I don't care. My passion is my family. And this is something that is good for my family, both for you as a professional and for our kids. And, you know, my family is my passion. I am going to be pursuing my passion. And that's what he did, and he was very persistent, and so here we are.
That's great. I'm sure there are people in this room who, you know, they like the company they work for, they like the industry they work for, but they are ready for some change. They might feel a little stuck. Curious if you guys have any advice on, you know, how do you kind of reinvent your career, even if you're not looking to leave your current role?
Let me start on that, because that happened to me. I had been doing equity research and heading the Mexico Strategy Department for, as I mentioned, 11 years. Probably when in year four, you know, I started getting antsy about what's next. I had grown so fast that 4 years in the same role, honestly, sounded like a lifetime. And there wasn't much that was there for me, you know, in the place where I was at. And so knocking on doors, being patient was key. And then talking to people. As Pipa said, it's a little bit of serendipity. I think a lot of serendipity, honestly. But at the same time, you have to push for it. So it's, where do I want to get to? More than the fact that you're taking a risk or not taking a risk, is where do I see myself? What's the point that I want to get to? What's the next step in my career? And as long as you have that clear, try to put a plan together to actually get you there. That means networking, that means meeting people, you know, knocking on doors within your own organization. If it is outside your organization, I am sure that there are ways to do it. I thankfully had the chance to move within JP Morgan, but I think that's the way that you need to do it.
Rafa, what about you?
Sure, thank you, Shelly. So for me, it's about being curious, right? It's really, really make sure that, again, as we have said before, you ask yourself the question, right? Not only to others, but to you as well. What if, right? What if I could do this, or what if I could play here, or what if you know, we could do this together, right? I think being curious, and with that, being open to learn, to fail, right? Because let's face it, it's and the serendipity, you know, comes into play here. It's we live an experiment, right? We are characters of a living experiment, and we. You do it quickly, you fail quickly, you learn from it, you move on, right? And so I think all those three elements to me are very close to each other, right? Curiosity, the need for learning, for asking what if, and then the relentless focus on experimenting, failing, and learning and moving on.
Yeah, I would double click on both of those. I would say, in addition to curiosity, being a good listener. So you ask the question, listen. Listen to yourself when you're asking yourself these questions. How does your body feel? Does that feel right? But I think listening to, you won't learn if you're not listening. So yes, you have to have a curious mindset, open mindset, but then also listen. The other thing I would just say, back to the risk-taking, I think the last 2 years, how crazy they've been, we only have today. There's no guarantee for tomorrow. So what do you want to do? And then how does that sit with you? I think that's perhaps a blessing of this very strange time that we've all gone through, is to kind of do that deep dive.
You talked a little bit about timing earlier, and when to know the right timing, Pippa, when you were thinking, when am I going to go to the Obama administration? Is now not the right time, but maybe in a couple of years? How do you kind of decide, okay, now's the time. Now's the time to do it.
Well, those were external deadlines, right? There's the Constitution of the United States. He'll serve 2 terms. That's it, if that. So, but I also wanted to have a family. So I was living in New York and practicing here. I had my 2 babies here in New York. They were like, we're island girls. We're from Manhattan. I'm like, okay. And that was the first Obama administration. And then I said, wow, when he was reelected, if I want to do this, this is the time. So with my 2 little ones, ages 2 and 1, moving back to D.C. and working those crazy hours. But I knew it was kind of now or never. So there was an external component to that decision.
Yeah, so, you know, for the people in the room that have worked or know a little bit about policy development, we like to think about windows of opportunities, right? And I think it's exactly what you're saying, people. I mean, we need to be aware that those windows are there, and these are doors that open and close at all times, right? So when the opportunity comes, grab it, right? Go after it. And that's one critical element. The absolutely ideal time to change a path or to change a career will never be there. Right? It's almost impossible. So use what you know. But going back, going back to what you said about listening. Listen to yourself, right? So, you know, there's something that I have always felt when I'm moving out of a position, and it's, if I wake up in the morning, and the day I wake up and I feel, I'm kind of not in the right energy to do this anymore, that's the moment when I listen to myself and I say, okay, now it's time for me to go after someone else, right? And just one last thought here. Never walk away from something. Always go towards something new, right? Because that makes it seems like a semantic, you know, position, but it really means a lot in terms of the energy that you're going to be putting behind your effort, and therefore the consequences of that effort, right? So really, those are drivers, critical drivers to me.
You mean like if you're unhappy with your current state, don't necessarily take the first job that comes available. Wait.
really make a conscious, deliberate, honest, you know, decision with what is it that you want. And this is especially true, you know, for both men and women, right? And if there's something that I'm very grateful, and I was talking to some other person during the break, is that, you know, this idea that men need to be open to pull women up, it works both ways as well, right? And so I'm grateful that some of the women that are here in this room at some point pulled me up. They said, Rafa, what if, right? What if? And I heard, and so I'm very happy for it. So yeah.
I think that's a great point about looking out among the people who are coming under you and saying, you might not feel ready, but you're ready. I promise you, you're ready. You can do it.
I think that you framed it perfectly, what I was going to say. I don't want to be the odd one out. Of course,
that's
you need
good.
To be proactive and, of course, looking for the opportunities. But at the same time, you know, you don't have to go after every opportunity. Listen to yourself. I think that's key. It feels. I mean, you actually feel it. And I don't want to be esoteric or anything like that. But you kind of feel it in your gut. Like, does it really sit with me or it doesn't? Does it make me anxious maybe to make this change? Maybe it's not the right change for me. Does it bring me a little bit of tiny peace? I mean, yeah, if I'm nervous about everything else that's going to bring. But, you know, does it kind of sound better? Then if you listen, if you're conscious enough about how you feel about it, your body, your mind, they're gonna give you the answer beyond, you know, pros and con lists and so on. But it doesn't necessarily have to be every single opportunity that comes your way. I think that what Rafa pointed out, there are times in which you might wake up and say, I don't want to do this, but then next day you feel energized again. And so you don't have to take decisions on a rush. Opportunities will be flowing your way. And trust me, I think that, you know, the right opportunity will always come along. I know it's very cliche to say that, but it does. And when it comes, it's going to be the right opportunity for you.
And Shelly, let me add something, because Noor just pointed out something very important that, again, has been said before. It's we need to learn how to feel comfortable in an uncomfortable, you know, position, right? And so the story here is, I took on this idea of experimenting and all that, I took a lesson on jujitsu, right? And of course, you know, in my first turn, I was on the floor, you know, with my back on the floor and with a big girl, you know, on top of me. And I was like, get off me, right? And then, of course, you know, at the end of that class, you know, she came to me and said, you need to learn to feel comfortable even when you're uncomfortable. Because when that happens, and with you, take a breath, right? And I was looking at her, right? And she said to me, well, these are the two moves that you need to make, right, to be able to get out of your position. Simple moves. I mean, this was not. It didn't require me a lot of strength even. But that's the key. And you will find those moves. You will understand those moves. But you need to be calm. You need to be listening to yourself and feel comfortable, even if it's in an uncomfortable position, right?
Yeah. I also feel though that sometimes you don't know there's never going to be a right time. You know, I feel like, to your point about the young kids, the 2 and 1 year old, I was living in Hong Kong and we had wanted to get pregnant and it wasn't happening. So I was like, okay, I might as well take this big job that I'm going to have to travel to mainland China 2 weeks out of the month. And then, you know, 2 weeks later, this is what happens, you know, like that was my first. So you just don't really know when things are going to necessarily happen. And then you kind of have to adjust.
Life happens and you have to go with the flow and you need to learn how to accept that. And it's not about not taking a proactive role, but also knowing that it's okay if you don't. that if you just let things happen, you'll be okay.
So speaking a little bit about work-life balance, flexibility, opportunities to recharge, as we kind of reinvent the workplace here with the pandemic, some people are all remote, some people are hybrid, some people want to be in the office all the time. What's the best way you guys have found with your staffs and your employees? What's the best balance you guys have been able to strike?
Not such a thing, no. I think one of the things that I've learned over the years is about to do a very deliberate effort to actually listen to what people need, right? And you will be surprised because we used to take decisions because of our own paradigms, right? As managers or leaders, and when you are able to listen, you probably find ways to adjust, you know, company processes in a way that people find that sweet spot, right? To balance the balance their lives, right? And so I'm just going to give you an example. And this is an example out of a book. One company was frustrated because they found that they didn't have 100% all the time, 24 hours attention of their employees. And this is no surprise to you, particularly with women, right? And then they decided to ask the question, and they found out that most of these women, you know, they were doing other stuff in addition to paying attention to their careers and their jobs, and they were dropping the kids at school, and they were going to do groceries, and they were this and that and the other thing, and they decided in a very interesting way to change the way women would have to report on what they were doing, allowing precisely for those moments to be part of the person's life. And then all of a sudden, what they found out is that performance improved, right? Collectively, employee satisfaction, you know, went up. And actually, they started to listen more and implement and adjust some of their corporate processes to actually allow this for this to happen. So again, back to my initial point is really about listening and being bold and adjust. In today's world, now that virtual and remote work is a must, I really don't see how a company can enforce, people to actually go to the office every single day, right? So, but to be to that point, to get to that point, you need to be open to listen and actually to change and to be bold on the actions that you're taking.
Well, what's the policy at your company?
So it's a good question. So at Organon, our CEO has been very clear. You are not obligated to be in the office, period. Now, at the same time, what he's saying is, now, we want people to collaborate because we understand that there's a spark. There's something that happens. There's magic when people get together, right? So if you're going to collaborate, if you're going to go to the office, make sure that you go when all the people are also going. Your team is going. When you have a purpose to be there as a team and as a group to collaborate, to discuss, to turn down barriers and so on and so forth. If that's not the case, do your work remotely, because on the other hand, statistics have shown that actually when you give that luxury or that opportunity to people, performance actually go up, right? So, so that's how Organon perceives remote working.
Nora, what about you?
Have you guys heard Jamie Dimon?
So Jamie Dimon, meet Mike Bloomberg. There.
Yeah, we're not as flexible. So, I mean, the mandate is to come back to the office. They want us back into the office. Each department can sort of manage that to a certain extent, and so there are some who are saying you need to be back every day, you need to be back only 4 days a week, but you cannot take Fridays off, or you cannot take Mondays off, or you can be 3 days, but you know your days at home cannot be Monday and Friday. I mean, managers have found a way that they think the flexibility or the flexible arrangements works for their own business. I am personally, and since I became a mom, as I mentioned, my passions, I mean, work, top priority for basically 30 years of my life, took a tiny step down, and then two little people jumped into the ladder and took that first place. I believe in productivity, 100%. So I've always done so, even before the pandemic. I don't know how many of you guys know what equity research looks like, but equity research is long hours, like long, I mean weekends. And with my team, I was always very, if you want to call it flexible, because it's the word that's in vogue right now, but I don't know, it wasn't called flexibility at the time. It was, I think, more like being pragmatical. You don't need to be here. If your company's only going to be reporting at, you know, 7 p.m., what the hell are you doing here, you know, starting 6 a.m. if you don't have anything? I mean, if your purpose is to write on this company, which is reporting late, come in late. If your company's reporting at 6 and you're done for the day at 12, I don't want you just to be, you know, warming the seat. Go home. Do stuff that's actually more beneficial to you. So I personally, with my teams, have always been this way. Now, in my own role right now, of course, I have very little flexibility because I've just changed, and so I'm adapting, and there's a commute, and so on. But what I'm finding after 2 months into a role is that you can actually do find ways to make both things work in terms of the work-life balance. One other thing that's key here, please take the ideal work-life balance thing out of your mind. There's no ideal. There's not one mold fits all work-life balance. You'll find your own work-life balance and how it works out for you. For me, what it's working out is that 3 days, I come to the office every day. I get here very early. I literally take like the 5:30 train out of, you know, Westchester. And I am here very early. 3 days a week at least, I try to leave before 2, so that's 1:30, which is scandalous to some people, but I don't care at all, because I want to be home to pick up my kids, and then I connect back on, you know, I log back on, and I work for the rest of the evening. And 1 day a week, I do stay late here in the office because it's my heavy day, and then I try to work from home 1 day a week if possible, but that's the way that it's worked out for me. For many other people, it's like I'm going to be working from home more days a week or not, or maybe starting my day later so that I can go and drop off my kids, or, I mean, you need to find your own way, but I think, once again, going to the point of listening to yourself, being true to yourself, it's about that, and communicating that with your manager. I don't think that, let me put it this way, 80% of the managers that you're gonna find from this point onwards are not gonna be a clear-cut no to a reasonable demand for flexibility. I mean, if you're a trader and you wanna be out by 11, that's not gonna work out. But, you know, a reasonable demand for flexibility.
What about you, Pippa?
It's very challenging, I guess. So we're lucky we're having this conversation. We don't work in a clinical lab where you need equipment, or in the hospitality industry where you need to be there, right? So that's the first thing. I think for my role and my company, it's very federated, spread around the world. So if I wanted to have a leadership team meeting, it's like, okay, how many time zones? Hi, Hannah Puller, my chief of staff here. Hi, Hannah. I'm like, please, what's going to work for Beijing and, you know, London and Brussels and Brazil and et cetera? So forget about it. So we do virtual because we can't. Oh, and by the way, let's not forget that most of China was off and on again in a total lockdown this year. So I can't be telling my colleagues in Beijing and Shanghai, go to the, I mean, it's just, what are you talking about? So global mindset, flexible. We've all learned a lot about each other. I guess the other approach that I try and have back to the listening point is that I like people and I like to know what's going on with them. So I ask, how are you? What do you need? How's your family? Because I think to be an effective collaborator, you need to have situational awareness as to what's going on with people. Maybe they're taking care of their children by themselves and their parents, you know, or maybe they're sick, or maybe their spouse is sick. You don't have a clue. So I try and ask a lot of questions, and we just knit it together, cobble it together, right, Catalina? I don't know. This week we do it this way, next week that way. But I think because of the role, I have to think about the globe. I don't think one way of doing anything will work universally.
I love the breadth of the different answers, right? Because what it shows you is that we're at a time and a moment where when you're looking at what your next career step is, it's kind of up to you to decide which one of these different models you want to go and work for and that align for your life right now. Like our interns, for example, at Bloomberg, they gotta be in the office. It's the only way you're gonna learn when you are 21 years old is, you know, when you're in the office and you're asking questions and you don't feel like the pressure of having to put a Zoom appointment on my manager's calendar where you can just turn around and ask them. I also feel like your routine switches, so that works for you now to go home at 2 p.m. because your kids are going to be home from school, right? When they go to high school, maybe not so much, and you might change it. You know, I was always a nighttime person. With this pregnancy right now, I'm asleep by 8 o'clock, and I'm awake at 5 a.m., so I go to the office, and I'm working at 5 a.m. So I feel like it kind of changes as your life goes on, and you can kind of pick when you are switching careers, kind of what you want to look for, you know, in that next role. But I liked your point about, Noor, a reasonable request to your manager. How do you kind of sit down and think through that where, you know, it's like, how do I explain to somebody who might not really understand my circumstances what I need and why is it important to put that out kind of like on the table there?
Absolutely. First of all, let's make the assumption here that you're a high producer employee, right? Because if you're slacking, I don't think that you can make any...
That's rough.
Yeah, exactly. I don't think that you can make any requests. So let's start from the point that you're actually, you know, you over-delivered through the pandemic. You more than showed that you're capable of doing it, which we, and at that point, we were all obliged to do that, right? So it's, first of all, you have the history. You have your performance, let's say. And then you come to your manager and, okay, John, I need to speak to you. Oh, yeah, welcome. So, you know, I'm not, the way that I do it is very candidly, honestly. But that's the way that works for me, right? I think that honesty trumps everything. And so I'm not feeling well. And we're assuming here that your manager is happy with you because you're a high performer and he values you in his team or in her team and so on. And so I'm not feeling well. This ABC is not working for me. I need to find something different. And then you go on and say, you demonstrate with facts. I think facts are key, right? It's not just about how I feel and my emotions and it's killing me and blah, blah, blah. You need to be sure. In the workplace, it's all about facts. Nobody's gonna hire you just because you're pretty. Unless you're a model. But you need to think about, you need to lay out your facts. So during the pandemic, we were working remotely and I was able to achieve A, B, C, D. Our returns in the portfolio went up by X, Y, Z, D. And you know, numbers, put numbers to it. Make it palpable. And so that way, once you go through your entire list, which I'm sure is going to be pages long, you can actually make your request. Like, okay, so I'm not feeling well. I've already stated the problem. Here's the arguments.
and here's my request. That's the way that I would structure it.
A similar along that note about kind of creating your own destiny, have anyone on this panel, have you guys ever written your own job description?
It goes back to innovation. It goes back to pushing, you know, the edge of what's known, right, from an organization perspective. And on the other hand, you have to have someone that actually is willing to take the risk, right? Because it goes both ways. So yeah, I have had the luxury over my career to create new jobs, right? To basically create new roles. Probably in ways, again, under this logic, this premise of experimenting, right? But really saying, you know what, it makes sense. We might not know for sure what's going to be at the end of the process. It makes sense now. Let's work it out. And you know, back to what Noor was saying, and it applies also to that. Bring the solution. Bring the options that will help the other person to understand, to be with you on the same page, and to see the future the same way you're looking at it. Right. So, this is not working for me, but these three options might. Right. So be open and be bold and be intentional also about teaching others, showing how to make it work. Because again, managing people, it will never be a science, right? It will be something that we learn how to do as we go, but that we need to use, you know, successes and failures of the past to actually improve it, right? So yeah.
That's great. I want to take this time to open it up to questions. If anyone has questions for anyone in our audience,
can I quickly piggyback on that?
Oh yeah, sure. Go ahead.
I just want to
start thinking about your questions while Pippa answers.
We were talking in the previous panel a lot about trailblazing. So I feel like I've constantly showing up as the only one, the first, the blah. Okay, I joined the wrestling team. Okay, I did this, and it's like okay. So I'm writing my job description all the time. That's kind of charting your destiny, hopefully. I mean, you can't just ram it through, but I guess I would, so I'd flip it just to say, write your job description every day. You know, what do you want to do? Especially for those who have not, many of us, who have not had or seen anyone like them in that role. If I'm waiting for someone else to define that, I'll just be sitting over here all day. Got to speak up, craft it, do it, go. And then bring the evidence, obviously, to back it.
No, I think what Pippa's saying is key, by the way, for all the younger crowd who are listening to us and for the not-so-young crowd as well. We're living in a world in which everything is moving at light speed. So if you, your question was, are you able to create your job or your job description, or have you in any ways have any sort of inference in your job description, I'd say that you better. You should be making your own job description every single day, because if you stick to the job description that was given to you by HR the moment that they hired you, I'm sorry, you're screwed. I mean, literally. You're going to have to innovate. Where's the value added, right? If you're just giving me what was expected of you, how am I supposed to make you grow? Where's your career going? So you definitely need to be pushing those boundaries and taking that job description to the next level.
And probably not looking at, looking at what your predecessor did, but also saying, okay, maybe the job was like that under that person, but look what I can take it to on the next level. Do we have any questions in the audience? Oh, over here.
Yeah, I have one question. So you all are talking about being like the first in a lot of things, right? So when I think about authenticity, sometimes we have this tendency to try to, I don't know how to say it in English, but in Spanish it's mimetizarse, like being part of the, like trying to be the same as the people that are in the room.
Huh?
Blend into the room. So, and it's something I believe that it's a part of how we can face the challenges, or just to, because you don't want to be different. So how do you embrace that difference that you have inside yourself to be part of that room and be in a different voice? I would like from you to get a couple of thoughts on that. Thank you.
Do you want to get started?
I'll just say, try to connect as a human, right? We're people. So I don't blend. I'm a black woman in America. I don't blend. I just do my thing. But I've lived in many places, lived in many countries. I speak other languages, and that's part of my curiosity, wanting to know, listen. But I think if you get down to it, no matter who, you can relate. You know, do you like to eat? You know, do you have a family? What's your passion? You know, and I try and start there.
I wouldn't try to blend, to be honest. I mean, I try to connect, for sure, because everybody is different in a way. You know, some people are different because of their name, because of their background, because of the color of their skin, because whatever, but everybody's different in a way, so I wouldn't try to blend. I mean, you've seen my name. I'm Mexican. Whenever I came into a meeting, they were like, they didn't know what to expect. Man, woman, animal, thing. They had no idea. And then, of course, I was many times, you know, the only woman in the room and the only, speaking to these big portfolio managers, and I was there like, hey, yeah, I should be investing in XYZ. So you need to be true to yourself. You shouldn't blend. You should connect, but you shouldn't blend.
Yeah, when it's a great question. When I think about that, reflect about that, it's also overcoming your fear, right? And to do that, you need to be able to trust one person, at least one, in the room, that you can connect with or relate to, right? And ask the question or address the topic. And it only takes that, right? Because as soon as you connect, as you, we were saying, you find a different world in front of you. And I, you know, that, you know, I've learned a lot by actually being here at the Council of the Americas every month, meeting with ministers of finance. I'm a medical doctor, right? So, and these guys are a different level. And it just takes that. One person that you see them in the eye and you feel that they can talk your same language, right? And you trust yourself, you believe, you trust yourself, and there you go. Jump at it, just hear, what do you think about this? I mean, right? Be open to learn, right? So what do you think about this? And then you connect. And then what happens is that most of the times, because you're different, right? Because your perspective adds so much value, diversity and belonging and all that, but because it adds so much value, then what you will see is that people look at you like, listen, thank you, right? It's great that you brought your voice and your perspective. So it just takes overcoming your fears and a little bit of trust.
And I think asking questions, to your point, you know, why is it that you guys do it this way? What is it? Why is it always like this or like that? Oh, well, that's interesting. Have you ever thought about trying it this way? You know, where you kind of figure out why everything is maybe one way before you necessarily try to change everything up. And then they might think you have the best idea in the entire world because they never heard it before. So I think there's a couple back there.
Thank you all. Just a quick question as we're talking about career paths. What is something that you've learned perhaps a bit later in your career, and knowing what you know now, is an advice that you'd give to your younger self? Because I think Susan made a reference to that, right? We learned a few things sometimes later, and it took us longer to get what we wanted, perhaps, so we were unhappy in certain places for longer than we should have been. So, yeah, I'm just interested, looking in hindsight, what is the advice that you'd give to someone, to yourself, and that I'm sure we can all apply it to our lives right now. Thank you.
I can jump, literally, no. Be humble, right? I mean, and it goes back to some of what, you know, has already been said, but recognize the savvy in others because of where they come from, because of what they have done, because of how they think. But to forget about arrogance. I mean, try to take it out of you, and learn from that, and squeeze and take as much as you can, because if you do that constantly, almost as a mechanism, right? It will definitely offer opportunities that otherwise would not present themselves. And so when I look at my career, often I was not that humble. And I think I could have gone many different ways. I could have, you know, do many other things, but I was too quick to react. I mean, it's like a matchbox, right? Too quick to react. No, take your time, learn. Recognize the difference in the other and recognize the value that brings to you, right? And when that, so to me, that's kind of my reflection. I tell this to myself still today, and it's paying off now, not before, but now.
I think that's key, and I mean, that's number one. If I have to do a number two, is don't be afraid to ask questions. Everybody's afraid in many meetings, you know, our juniors are like, I didn't want to ask that question because that would be a dumb question, and I, you know, there's no dumb questions. Don't be afraid to ask questions. The worst that can happen is that somebody tells you, no, that's like your floor. Yeah, I mean, you're not going to go below or you're past that, you know, floor is the floor. And so no is your floor. That's it. Don't be afraid to ask questions.
What about you?
Maybe I'm a lawyer, so this is a lawyer response, but you got to sweat the details, be prepared, and include and follow through, right? Maybe if I were an artist, I'd have a different answer, different answer. But I think that's something that my craft taught me, but I appreciate. And so as you're coming up, get into it, get dirty with it, get to know the problem that you're wrestling with, so that you're prepared when you're in the meeting. And that one little thing that you were like, well, maybe I'll look into that, that's the relevant point at that moment, and you're ready. So I think dig deep, sweat it, get to know it.
I think that's great. I would just say ask for what you want. Don't be afraid to do that. And also take advantage of the opportunities that are handed to you. So for me, I always thought, oh, well, this job, there's nothing posted, so there's nothing to apply for. Well, what if you come up with your own job and then you pitch it to your manager? And the more times you ask and you come with a coherent strategy and you present, then it's really hard for people to say no to you. And you know, the other thing I tell a lot of our younger employees, we have a lot of CEOs and heads of state and folks who come in, and they get the opportunities to sit in those rooms. Some people don't ever ask one question, and I say, why are you in this room? You know, if you're in this room, if you're at this table, and you have the CEO of X company in front of you, make it known that you're there, ask a question, and take the opportunities that are presented to you.
Can I just say something on the back of that? Because that reminded me of an anecdote. I'm going to tell you how I got hired by JP Morgan 11 years ago. I was working at Credit Suisse. Not a very, you know, good thing to say nowadays, but you know, I was working at Credit Suisse. And we got invited to a conference as clients, a conference that JP Morgan was putting together in Mexico City. And there was Agustin Carstens, who's now president of the of the I forgot the word. The BIS, right. And back then he was governor of Central Bank, and he was very well regarded, like super respected, like everybody bowed to him. And there I am, you know, a 29-year-old, 28-year-old, clearly had absolutely no idea how the world worked, and he was saying something about inflation. I was like, I disagree. The room went quiet. What are you saying, miss? And like, super serious. I stood up and I said, I disagree because I don't even remember. Like, and so I'd like to ask you a question, blah, blah, blah. And he said, I don't remember. Like, he was very blunt. He had a very blunt answer to me, saying very dismissive. And, you know, that was my floor. He said no. And that was my biggest loss. And then, yeah, I came out of the room saying, well, yeah, I still disagree, but the guy pretty much put me in the spotlight, and so, okay. 2 seconds later, the head of LATAM Equity Research came to me and said, I have a job offer for you. That was boldness, because I asked the question. I was not afraid.
That's a great place to end it. This was really wonderful. I really appreciate it. Take all these lessons, and I hope you guys enjoyed the rest of the program. Thank you.
Thank you, Pipa, Rafa, Noor, and Shelly, for a great conversation and finding fulfillment in our careers. We're now moving into our final segment of the conference, our lunch conversation with table leaders. As a reminder, this part is off the record. So thank you, everyone who joined us online, and we hope you're back with us next year. So now with that, I'm going to leave you in the hands of Randy Melsey, our Vice President for Public Policy Programs and Corporate Relations here at the American Society Council of the Americas, to introduce the table leader session. Randy.
And congratulations, Guillermo. It's the first time we have an